Alright, so looking at this table, for one thing, for a linear function, the reason why it's linear is because the graph of it would be a straight line. It would just move at a straight line, whether it goes up or it goes down or stays flat, it goes straight, up and down. Right? A linear function is a line. You graph all of the points. If I were to graph all of these points, they would be in a straight line going up. Okay? So to figure out how many dollars per hour, which is always a really handy thing to know, it makes writing that formula a lot easier. Well, this one's pretty easy because the hours go up by how much?
One hour.
And how many dollars do we see increased in that 1 hour?
Four.
So for this example, since the hours goes up by one, it makes it pretty easy to see how many dollars per hour we're making, right? How many is that?
$4
every hour. It must be. If I were to continue this pattern, $10 would see four more dollars. 47, yeah, that is four more dollars than 43. And on it goes. And on and on and on it goes. So if I made $4 an hour, you might think, let's cover these up for a second. Forget about them. If I told you that you make $4 an hour and you work for 7 hours, $4 an hour, you work for 7 hours, how much money should you make? How'd we get there? $4 an hour times 7 hours, $28, right? Okay, how much I should make? How about after 8 hours, how much money should I make?
32.
So it seems like your formula, at least to start with, should just be $4 an hour times the hours, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Except, how many dollars did we just say for 8 hours? 32, but look at how much money I do have, 39. So it must mean, like, if you had a job, and you made $4 an hour, quit that job, but first of all, consider, you've worked for 8 hours, you should make $28, but you have $39. Sorry, you should have $32. You worked for 8 hours, you should have $32, but you have $39 instead. Which means, go all the way back to the beginning of that day, what must have been true? You just had $7 to start with.
Yep,
right? Gotcha. You had $7. You walked into work and you started making $4 an hour.
Plus seven.
Add on $7 that you had to start with. Right? There's no need to change what you multiply by. Right? No need to change what the rate is. It's definitely $4 every hour. Every hour you see go up here, you see the dollars go up by four. But we had $7 extra. That should work for any of these. Let's try it for 10, four times. 10? Well, at 10 hours working $4 an hour, I should make $40, right? 40 plus the extra 7 I started with, not 4, 40 plus the 7 extra dollars you started with, should be 47. Is that what the table says?
Yes.
I start at 7, go up $4 an hour after that. 4x plus 7. Another way of putting it, I just kind of said it a second ago, right? I said back up to the beginning of the day. At 0 hours, you must have started with $7. So that in 8 hours, when we go up by $32, that's how we can wind up with $39. If you feel like a super expert, you should definitely be writing this down. All right, continue to the next one. So there's not to be a dead horse or that. In this example, again, considering this to be hours for X and dollars for Y, how many hours have gone by between 5 and 6 hours?
1.
1 hour has gone by. What's been the change in dollars?
3.
-4. -3. Change in dollars is going down. It's going down.
Oh, they're negative.
-$3. -$3 in 1 hour. Think about that for just a second. -$3 every 1 hour. How could that happen? How can we have -$3 an hour?
You're not working.
You're not working. So where's the negative part coming from?
You're spending.
You owe money.
You're owing money every so many hours? Cody?
You're watching the movie.
really, really, really long movie.
Okay, you pay for an hour of the movie.
Seriously, yeah. That'd be stupid.
And you just see how long you can go. Okay. What's your good example, Matt?
What?
What's your great fantastic example?
I don't have one.
You don't have one?
No.
You're just going to turn around and call other people's ideas stupid?
Sure.
Okay. So we lose $3 per hour because somehow we're owing money, and maybe watching this really long movie would be $3 an hour. Or maybe we're renting something, right? That costs us dollars per hour. Renting a piece of equipment or a room of some kind. Like we're renting something for a number of dollars per hour. That's how we could conceptualize having negative $3 per hour. So this is like, how much money do I have left after renting whatever for $3 every hour? Okay. Well, how much money have I spent after 2 hours?
-$6.
After 3 hours?
-$7. -$9.
Just based on the $3 per hour. Forget about everything except for the knowledge that you're spending $3 an hour. How about after 5 hours? Should be down $15, right? Should be -$15. So how are you doing that? How are you calculating that, Kelly?
Like, when you go up an hour, you lose $3, and so then you're just losing $3 every hour.
Seems like you did it faster than just adding on 3 or subtracting 3. No? Was there a faster way than just subtracting 3 a bunch of times?
Yeah, multiplying.
Yeah.
Multiplying, right? That is what multiplication is. It is adding on a number multiple times. So it would seem that we could take -3 and multiply by the number of hours to figure out how much money we paid. Right? And we said after 5 hours we should have spent what? We should be down how much?
15.
Should be down 15. But this thing here says I'm down 22. I should only be down 15, but I'm down 22.
-7.
So we must have started with -7? Must have started with -7.
Yep.
We back up to 0 time, 0 hours. Must have been -7 to start with. Maybe your mental math is as bad as mine, and you don't immediately think, oh, -7. Here's how we could figure it out. -3 times 5, right, is -15, but somehow the answer has to come out to be -22. Right? There must be some other number involved. We must have been subtracting 15 from something. Let's call it B. Well, then some number -15, which is the number we are already familiar with, some number -15 must be -22.
Seven.
If I want to solve for B, I would add 15 to both sides. We know our algebra, simple algebraic equation. -22 plus 15, -7. We all agree? Yes. Okay, so it must have been that we started with -$7. So I already didn't have $7. And I decided to start renting something for $3 an hour. And that's good news. If you're sitting there and thinking, like, yeah, I get all this, I'm fine. Just try and beat me to this answer here. Try and beat us all to the final formula here. Okay? Again, we're going to try to figure out how many dollars every hour, right? Dollars every hour. How many hours have passed between 5 hours and 12 hours?
7
hours between 5 and 12 hours. How many dollars? Well, it's increasing, right? That's good. So how many dollars is it increasing? Between $32 and $74,
42.
How much is it increase? How did we figure out 42?
74 minus 32.
All right, so we just kind of like this, as we're looking for a cookie cutter approach, we can just take the ending amount, 74 minus 32. What did we figure out? 41? 42? So, I've seen my money increase by $42 in how long?
7 hours.
7 hours, James? Dollars per hour? $42 in 7 hours is $6. That's $6 every hour. told you you're making $6 an hour, you would say, you know, you would assume that like after 3 hours, you're making $6 an hour, how much money would you have then? Forgetting about all that. If I make $3 an hour, $6 an hour for 3 hours, I should have 18. If I work for 10 hours, at $6 an hour, how much money should I have then? 60, right? After 5 hours, making $6 an hour, how much money should I have? Are all just based off the information that I make $6 an hour. But look, after 5 hours, where I would expect to have $30, I have instead $2. What does that mean about how much money I had to start with?
You start with $2.
Start with $2. If we back up to zero hours, we would see, you know, in that wallet, $2.
I'm done.
A little more straightforward. You would think that if I want to know how much money I have after so many hours, X hours, making $6 an hour, I should just take $6 an hour times the number of hours. But when I try it for 5 hours, I would expect to see 30, but I see it said 32, so that must be added on to some beginning amount. What should I begin with? B, whatever it is, plus the $30 should come out to be 32. This one's not too hard to see. We subtract 30 at both sides. B's got to be 2. So we have that 2 added on as well. So $6 an hour times X hours plus the $2 you must have started with if after 5 hours we have 32 instead of $30. Let's notice something here. For a linear function, I should be able to use any two points at all, and just randomly pick those 2 points. Should be able to use those two to figure out everything I need to know. If you think about it, for the last 3 problems, to figure out the formula, we didn't use these 2 points, we used these two points. All we did was use just the first two. I could use the middle two, the last two, or the first one and the last one, it's all the same. The only thing we really used the rest of the table for was to just check and make sure that our formula works for whatever, for 10 or for 8 or whatever we choose. So that's one part of it. For a linear function, all you need is 2 points. You don't even need to worry about the rest of that table, the rest of those other 2 points. If you want to check your work, that's what that table is nice for. But not necessary to find the formula. So number 4. So you gotta notice like the theme here on the front page, the first 4 is the rate of change is always a nice round number. Even if it's negative, it's a nice round number. We'll see that here as well. Thinking of this again as hours and this as dollars. At 3 hours, there's $2. At 7 hours, there's negative $14 in our pocket. How many hours have gone by between 3 and 7? 4 hours. If there's a bigger gap and you're not sure, you could always subtract, right? 7 minus 3 gives you 4. How many dollars? Well, it's a decrease in dollars, right? So how much decrease have we seen between $2 and negative $14? Negative 16, because we have to go back. So here we are, I'm trying to think of your perspective. $2, right? 1, 2 to the right of 0. We have to back up and go back 2, right? Subtract 2. Then we have to get to negative 14. We subtract 14 more. Right? We've already subtracted 2. Subtract 14 more. We're subtracting 16 to get there. So we have seen a decrease of $16 in 4 hours, which means?
Negative $4
every what?
Hour.
Every 1 hour. Okay, so now we've lost $3 an hour before. Now we're losing $4 an hour, right? What scenario might that be? How could there be a negative $4 an hour in our life?
Trying to think.
Is that?
We're spending money.
We're spending money, right? How do we have a negative? We have to have a loss, so we're spending money on something every hour. Okay. We're renting something, or playing a game, or watching a really long movie at $4 an hour. All of these are fine examples to help us conceptualize on how we have a negative rate. Negative $4 an hour. I can take a cue from the previous three problems. I should be able to calculate how much money I've spent by taking the amount of money I spend in 1 hour and multiply it by however many hours have gone by. Right? Multiply by the number of hours that have gone by. So if 1 hour goes by, I should see this be -4. I should spend $4. If 2 hours go by, I should spend $12. If 3 hours go by, how much money should I have spent? We should see a -$12. I guess, how much money should I have made, really? I've made -$12. Except for, at 3 hours, right? Instead of taking -4 times 3 and getting -12 instead, I take -4 times 3 and I got 2, which means, again, I should have some amount that I started with, began with. Well, that's the beginning amount. -$12 gives me $2. What amount of money must I have had to start with? Must have had $14 to start with, right? If we add 12 to both sides, or we just use our noggins to see that number must be 14. Another way of looking at it is, at 0 hours, I had $14. So I had $14 to spend. Go to my little rental place, whatever I'm renting, I don't know. In the other class, we decided it was a bike. Renting a bike for $4 an hour, renting it around the city. Okay. 3 hours have gone by, I'm down to $2, because I've lost $4 every hour. 7 hours go by, I am in debt to the bike rental place for $14. And as time goes on, I just go further and further in debt. Hopefully I'm done with that bike. It back and not be so negative. So we gotta add that $14 on that we have to begin with. So you can see this writing a linear function as we've got a rate times the number of hours, okay, plus this amount that we must have had to start with in order for the data to work out the way that it's working. In order for after 9 hours to be only down $22. Instead of being down $36, I must have had $14 to start with. Try beating this to the answer on number 5. Like I said, the theme for the first 4 was that rate, that dollars per hour, works out to a nice full number of dollars every hour. Here, I can tell you ahead of time, it's not. It's not going to work out to a nice round number of dollars per hour. So let's figure it out. It's going to work out to like a part. It's going to be some number of dollars and a little bit of a fraction of a dollar. Once again, you do not have to make everything dollars an hour. But just for the sake of consistency today, that's what we have. All right, so it was 4 hours. At 4 hours, I had $28. Then, after 12 hours, I had $64. Well, how many hours have gone by? Between 4 hours and 12
Eight.
Hours? 8 hours have gone by.
8 hours.
8 hours. Well, to figure out how many hours have gone by, I'm gonna write this over here. We can do 12 minus 4, right? That's really 8. How much money have we, well, first of all, do we make money or lose money? We're making money, we're going up in money. How much did we go up? How many dollars did we go up? What's that?
36.
64 minus 28, right? $36. How long did it take to make $36?
8 hours.
8 hours. That's like a full day's worth of work. 8 hours, you made $36. Good job or bad job?
Bad.
Do not stay at that job. I don't know why you're there. You should leave immediately, unless you make insane tips. You should leave. Well, that doesn't work out to like $6 an hour, $5 an hour. It works out to like some dollars and then part of a dollar. If I'm going to leave this as a fraction, am I going to? I see these both are divisible by 4. This is 9, this is 2, so 9. 9 over 2. That could be $9 every 2 hours, just like that's $36 every 8 hours. It could be 9 halves of $1 in 1 hour. Better?
Or 4.45.
4.5, you might say 4.50 an hour, $4.50 an hour. All of these things are equivalent to each other. 4.50 an hour, 9 halves of a dollar per hour, $9 every 2 hours. Which makes sense, because if we use what Tyler said, 4.50 an hour, right, that's half of $9. 4.50 an hour for 2 hours, how much money would we have made in 2 hours if we're making 4.50 an hour? $9, of course, $9 every 2 hours is that fraction there says. You might write it as 4.50, I'm going to go ahead and write it as 9 halves, which is the same as 4.50. You would think, to calculate how much money I have, I would take 4.50, or 9 halves, and multiply it by what?
4.
Why 4? Oh, for this one?
Yeah.
Specifically for that one? 4, or?
Sure.
Yeah, any number of hours x, right? But we will use that 4, it's going to be a handy thing to use. It should just be, like if I want to figure out after 4 hours, it should be 9 halves times 4. Should be. 9 halves times 4, 9 halves times 12 should tell me how much I'm making after 12 hours, and so on and so forth. Well, that's true, then 9 halves times 4 should tell me how much money I have. What's 9 halves times 4? Mm-hmm. 18. You could do it 36 over 2, right? That's 18. You could do 2 divided by 4, that is 2, 9 times 2 is 18. In any case, it should come out to be 18. But once again, it doesn't. It comes out to 28, which means I must have 10 to start with. Must have had 10 to start with. Another way to look at it. I'm thinking 9 halves times 4 should come out to be 18, but it doesn't. It comes out to be 28, which means there's some extra. Right? There's extra there. B plus. We just calculated that to be 18. Must be the amount that I had to start with. Right here, plus 18 is 28. That's pretty easy to see. Right? Something plus 18 must be 28. Or sorry, must be 10. Starting with 10, if we subtract 18 from both sides, we'll find out, again, B, the beginning amount is 10. Well, here we went up with this 9 halves thing, or 4.50 or whatever. But it worked the same as every other example. The previous 4 examples, our rate times our time, how fast we're making money or losing money times the number of hours that have gone by. Of course, that would work whatever the variables represent. Whether they represent dollars and hours or boxes of cookies and days or puppies and weeks or whatever they might represent. Okay. Take your rate times the amount of time that's gone by. Figure out how much increase you've seen in dollars or boxes of cookies or whatever they might be. Okay, well, this example here, we see what's happening to our money.
It's going down.
It's going down, right? Like if we were to look at a graph of this, it would be going down as time goes up. See a decrease. See a decrease as time goes on. See how fast it's decreasing. How much time has gone by between 2 hours and 10 hours? Between 2 hours and 10 hours, how much time has gone by? 8 hours. How much money have we gone down by? Negative 20 is the change in dollars that we see. So we've seen a loss of $20 in 8 hours. And again, these do not, like 8 does not divide 20 nicely. So just leave it as this fraction of, well, these are both divisible by 4, that's 5, that's 2. So a loss of $5 every 2 hours. Or a loss of five halves of $1 every 1 hour. Both of those are valid, as you see in that ratio. $5 every 2 hours, five halves of $1 every 1 hour. So just as before, we get our rate. The negative 5/2 times the number of hours that go by. Think about it for a second. Should in 2 hours lose $5, how much should I lose in 1 hour? Negative 2.5. After 2 hours, how much money should I see change? Should be negative 5. How about after 4 hours? 10. $5 every 2 hours, so $10 every 4 hours, double the time, double the cost of money. Like you said, negative 5/2 times 2 should give me negative 5. Should give me negative 5, but I get instead 2. So I must have had some beginning amount that I've subtracted these $5 from, right? B minus 2 divides 2, which is 3 minus 5 equals 2. Add 5 to both. Must have started with $7. Okay. Whether you like to just apply common sense to it or you like to use algebra, either way we find to have $2 after 2 hours losing $2.50 an hour, 5 halves of a dollar per hour, must have started with $7. Zero time I must have had $7. Then to go down by $5 in 2 hours and wind up with $2. There's our plus 7. So the previous 6 examples we have looked at always dollars and hours, dollars and hours, dollars and hours. But now we're being forced to think of it in a different way. Instead of dollars and hours, it's what?
Minutes and chips.
Minutes and chips. As time goes by, Rufio eats more. Well, he's got to eat more chips, right? He can't eat fewer chips. So after 7 minutes, he's eaten 15. And after 12 minutes, he's eaten 25 chips. But that doesn't mean he ate 15 chips in 7 minutes. It doesn't mean he ate 25 chips in 12 minutes. It just means that at 12 minutes, he had consumed 25 chips. Okay? Figure out how fast he's doing this. How many chips has he eaten between these two times? How many chips has he eaten between these two times? He's eaten 10 chips. Hunter, how long has it taken him?
Question.
Yeah.
How about the last problem?
Okay, we'll get there when we get to the last problem.
Yeah.
The previous problem.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, misunderstood. What was your question? Did you get a loss of $20 or a loss of $16?
I got a loss of 20.
Loss of 20 in 8 minutes, right?
And then negative 20 divided by 8 equals negative 2.5.
Yes, negative 2.5, so it should be negative 2.5 times x. $5 between the 0 hours and 2 hours.
Oh yeah.
Wind up at a positive 2.
Yeah.
Alright, so he's eaten 10 chips. How many minutes have gone by that he's eaten these 10 chips? How many minutes?
Three.
3 minutes?
I don't think so.
7 minutes to 12 minutes? 5.
Eight.
5 minutes?
5.
So 7 chips every 5 minutes means he's eating?
2.
2 chips every
minute.
Every 1 minute. So 2 chips per minute. Okay, so you would think that if he ate these 2 chips per minute for 10 minutes, he ate, you'd think 20 chips.
Yeah.
He ate for 40 minutes, you'd think he ate 80 chips and so on.
Yeah.
But we know, for instance, that after 7 minutes, he's eaten 15 chips. If he eats 2 chips per minute for 15 minutes, how many do you think he would have eaten? 2 chips a minute for 7 minutes?
14 chips.
You would think you just take 2 times 7 and get 14, but we get 15, which means we must
plus
have
1.
So you give it, which is pretty clearly a 1. So 2 times 2 chips a minute times the number of minutes plus
minutes.
1 extra chip that he ate yesterday or something before we started this marathon chip eating.
Okay.
While ago we had a problem with chips.
What? While ago we had what?
We had a problem and we used chips. And
like
we used chips and then it left off.
What,
so,
this class?
Yeah.
Yeah, we
so,
did. That's why I wrote it this
same
way.
Dude.
Same dude eating chips.
Same chip.
2 chips a minute. Must have started out having eaten 1 chip for some reason. Just had 1 time. How many would he have eaten after 35 minutes? We can use our formula for that. 2 times 35. That's the 70 chips he eats after 35 minutes. 2 chips a minute. But he also has that extra one. 71 chips, had it?
Wait, the answer is
Part A is the formula, part B is he should have eaten 71 chips after 35 minutes.
Oh, okay.
He ate 2 a minute for 35 minutes, but he also had that 1 that he had already eaten before he started the stopwatch. He ate that 1 and he's like, hey, I'm going to time myself. He got past the 81 chips. Why is he eating them so slowly?
Because he's, whatever his name is, Rufio.
Rufio.
And he's a slow chip
eater.
And he's trying to annoy his roommate by crunching verse.
Maybe.
Oh. The other class thought he was trying to be polite, but maybe he was trying to be rude and just like crunch with his mouth open and his roommate's ear. Yeah? Just savoring it. All right, let's get this last one. Okay, this one, Luna, my wife gave me that name,
Luna.
Luna's delivering newspapers. After 7 minutes, there are 56 newspapers left. So this is not how many she's thrown out, but how many are left. The car, the basket, or she got these in. So there's 56 left, and after 12 minutes, there's 46 left. So let's figure out this formula. Well, she's losing newspapers, right? How much does it go down from 56 papers to 46 papers?
10.
Loses 10 papers. 10 papes. In how many minutes?
Oh, yes.
5 minutes? From 7 minutes to 12 minutes? 5 minutes. Okay. So that means that she's delivering?
2.
Right? 2 papers every 1 minute. So you might think that after 10 minutes, she's managed to make the amount of papers go down 10, right? She's just down 10. Okay. Or that after 7 minutes, if she's delivering 2 a minute, she should be down to negative 14, right? But negative 2 times 7, instead of getting negative 14, the number of papers that are left are at 56, which means she must have started with some papers, right, at the beginning. How many papers? Well, we can figure that out if we're not, you know, our mental math is not fast, which mine is not. I know that B minus 14 for those 7 minutes, delivering it 2 a minute, should come out to be 56, add 14, right? Of course she must have had, right? She must have had 14 more papers 7 minutes ago. That's where we're adding the 14 on. to the 56, which means she must have started with 70 papers. Started with 70 papers. So the formula must be negative 2x, negative 2 papers per minute times x minutes plus the 70 she started with. Okay. Once that gets down to 0, then she's out of papers. And once it's negative, she must have ran out of papers too soon, and she owes all those people papers because, I don't know, she threw the two. Well, after how many
20 minutes?
After 20 minutes, she's delivered this many papers, taken those many papers from the 70 she started with.
30.
Negative 40 plus the 70 she started with. She must have 30 now. So, that's not what I meant to do. For any, your homework is get ready for the test tomorrow. Okay. For any of these, we can just take 2 points. In fact, the last two questions only gave you 2 points.
Uh-huh.
Here's 1 point. 7 minutes, comma 15 chips, 12 minutes, comma 25 chips. We just need 2 data points for a linear function. Those 2 points can be used to find the rate of change. Dollars per hour, if you want to just write it down to the same kind of rate of change. And with that information, we can write kind of like half of the formula, right? It must be rate of change times x. But then we can use a specific example to say, well, that didn't come out the way that it should, so we've got this extra to add on or extra to subtract.
That was actually pretty cool. I'm confident
in this test.
Good.
It was really good.